Look at your neighbor and say, we ought to be healed. And I'm going to show you in the Word how it proves that point. And if I can just get you to agree with me tonight that this Word is the Word of God, and if I can get you to agree that you're going to believe this book, and whatever this book says, you will buy it, go with it, and do it,
yes.
We can all walk out the door shouting hallelujah. So, because our problem is in the soulish area. If you're born again, it's certainly not your spirit, certainly is not sick. You're born again spirit man. But we've got to change our thinking to believe the Word of God. Okay, you found Luke? If you hadn't, you might as well close your Bible. Hallelujah. All right, Luke. Luke 13, let's pick up with verse 10. It's talking about Jesus now. And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath day. So let's get that straight right now. For those of you who think you don't need to go to church or you don't need to, you know, do anything, Jesus went all the time. He was there all the time. All right, here we go. All right. And behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and was bowed together and could in no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, woman, thou art loose from thine infirmity. He laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. And the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation because that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day and said unto the people, there are 6 days in which men ought to work. In them, therefore, come and be healed. But just die on the Sabbath. No, that's not what it really is. But don't heal anybody on the Sabbath. The Lord then answered him and said, thou hypocrite, does not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or his ass from the stall and lead him away to the watering? And ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, lo, these 18 years, ought not this woman be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day? Now, this was a daughter of Abraham. I want to remind you that you and I stand in a different place tonight. We stand in a place where Jesus has already gone to the cross, where he's already taken the stripes, where he's already been beaten, where he's already been by the stripes of Jesus, I have been healed, is what the Bible teaches. When this woman was here, Jesus was there walking as a Jew on the earth. Y'all do know Jesus was a Jew. All right. And he was walking on the earth. And you do know that he did not read from the New Testament. We understand that. Okay. And you understand Paul didn't read from the New Testament. Okay. You do understand that everything Jesus spoke from, he basically, everything came and can be documented from the Old Testament. And they came to fulfill, not to do away with, but to fulfill the Old Testament. And so here he is, and he's saying that if this woman is a daughter of Abraham, now let me put it in a little circle here about just being a daughter of Abraham, what it might mean. Let's make it simple. Abraham was the father of faith. Ought not this woman, who is a daughter of Abraham, who is a father of faith, friend of God, father of faith, ought not this woman be loosed, no matter what day it is?
Amen.
So the first thing Jesus did was to ask this woman to come to him. Here she is, you know, all bowed down. We don't know, you know, how far down she was or anything. But he called her to him and said unto her, woman, thou art loose from thine infirmity. Now, he told her she was loose before he touched her. He acknowledged who she was, that she was loosed, and then he laid his hands on her. Now, I'm convinced whether he laid his hands on her or not, she would have been loosed had she just grabbed hold of, I'm loosed. Because it's the Word itself that does it and has the power behind it. Again, there are many different ways that people can be healed. Laying on of hands, handkerchiefs, all kind of different ways that people can be healed. About 7 or 8 of them. All kind of different ways that people can be healed. But the one way I want you to grab hold of, because it's the most important, because no matter where you are, what island you're on, if you got this book and know the word of the Lord, you can bring healing and walk in healing without anybody ever laying hands on you, without anybody ever praying over you, without anybody ever anointing you with oil. And you know, if you're sitting there and the thought has just hit you, dear God, I've got the healer inside of me, and something that I've let come in through my mind some kind of way is blocking that healing power from getting to whatever part of my body it needs to get to, I'd be sitting there saying, well, glory, hallelujah, I've conquered one thing. Praise God, I found the healer. Oh, thank you, Jesus. So we've already, if you're born again, you already found the healer. Praise the name of the Lord. And again, I know some of us come from backgrounds where we never, ever even say amen out loud in church. I understand that. But you're not in your church tonight. So hallelujah. So you can say amen, holler, jump, scream. I don't care. But I do know this. If once I was hurting, and once I'm in pain, and once I realize that I got Jesus, and he's working in me to cleanse me, set me free, pushing out every kind of disease and sickness, honey, I'm not going to be quiet about it. Woo! Glory to God. I mean, if I can sit at my house and holler over the pain, I can certainly holler, hallelujah, that Jesus is greater than the pain. Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So let me just say this. Some of you may be at a place that you're so tired of what's been going on with the pain and all that's going on in your body that you may have decided, well, you know, I think I'll just go on to heaven. It's better. Well, it is better. I want to admit that. Heaven is better. We agree with that. Paul said that. In Philippians, he didn't say it quite that way, but that was in essence what he said. He said, I don't know whether I want to go be with Jesus or whether I want to stay here. And he said, for me, it's better to be with Jesus. For you, it's better that I stay around. Right. And this is what I'm trying to say to you. I need you to make your mind up that it's better for you to stay around. I need you to make your mind up that hell has lied to you, and you're not going to let him take your life. And you're not going to let him cut short what God has for you, and that you're going to live your life out to the fullest, and that you're going to trust God, and that you know that you are needed, that there are people to be won to the Lord. We have a very short time in which to do it, and we can't make you decide to stay, but you can decide to stay. And I want you to decide to stay. Yeah. Hallelujah. Now go over to Matthew 8. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Now, if Jesus would say, a daughter of Abraham ought to be healed, what in the world do you think he would say to us today on the other side of Calvary? When he said that by his stripes you are healed. I sent my word and healed you. And over again, he acknowledges that what he took, you know, and God Almighty remembers the day that those stripes were put on the back of Jesus for you and me for healing. So if you're going to ask the Lord what he thinks about your sickness, he's going to say, what sickness are you talking about? Because he knows Jesus took your pain and my pain and your disease and your sickness. That's what the Bible teaches. Yes. I'm sticking with Bible. I don't know what your church says. I'm teaching with Bible. Yes. Jesus is still in the healing business, my friend. He's an unchangeable God. All right, Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. I'm in Mark. Okay, Matthew chapter 8. I want to begin in verse 1. When Jesus would come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Now, this story has always fascinated me, because that guy was supposed to be over there in the tombs. He was supposed to be in the graveyard, the leper. He was not supposed to be out in public. He was not even supposed to be out there. And he was in the middle of a multitude. Now, I've said this for years. I've been teaching this far more years than I'd like to acknowledge. But some people get old, I get young. But I'm just saying that, thank you, honey, I'll give you a gift later. But anyway, what I'm saying is, it is amazing to me that everywhere in the Bible, basically, that you see someone have an experience with God. You see something, a miraculous happening. You see a great move of God from Old Testament through New Testament. The only people you even know in the Old Testament are the ones who acted out. I mean, they are the ones, David, who took a rock and hit a giant. I mean, they're ones who, when the armies were coming, got a horn and went toot toot in order to kill the armies, for God to rise upon his side. We're talking about, those who were sleepy and thrown in the lion's den and took a nap on the lion's back. I mean, we're talking about strange things. And we're talking about a Bible that is filled with people. And the only ones you and I know are the ones that did these wild things. Now, I don't know if you've noticed that's kind of how God is. Now, if you haven't noticed that and you are in a little while, you got to do these. God just likes to see. I think he calls it this way. He likes to make fools look great. That's my interpretation, Pastor. What you think? He likes to make fools look really good. You can find that kind of in Corinthians over there if you look. So you've got to just, go after it. You know what I mean? When everybody else is sitting down, you might be jumping up. When everybody else is just sitting there saying, well, I don't know. And you're sitting there going, glory to God, I know, And it's when God begins to rise up in you and you begin to do things that you would have never done in your whole life. But God just begins to rise up in you. You just said the entire Old Testament, at 12 spies, we only know two names. Who knows who those other 10 are? We don't even care. They made them walk around for 40 years, the other 10. Now, if I was there, I would have shot those fellas off. I mean, I don't know. But the two guys we know is Joshua and Caleb. We don't know the other 10. And it's always these who came back and said, everybody else, the giants thinks we are grasshoppers. They didn't get close enough to a giant. They didn't even let a giant see them. They sure didn't ask them a question. None of them walked up to a giant. Brother giant, you think I'm a grasshopper? Are you crazy? That was in their mind, their interpretation. And then you got Joshua and Caleb who come back and say, hey, we see what our God do. He parted the Red Sea. Bless God. He did this and he did that. Said, this is nothing for our God. That was their whole attitude. Huh, this is big enough for God. Don't get up against God. Huh, come on, join up with God. We can do this thing. Two guys and the everybody because of the other 10 nuts. They ended up 40 years. And on top of that, they all died. Yes. Amen. Because of choices. Because of the way they looked at God. Because how they saw God. What their interpretation of God. How big God was to them. They died in the wilderness at their own mouth. Read your Bible. Because they made their call. Read your Bible. Yes. And when you come over to the New Testament, the folks you know, the woman with the issue of blood. Here she is in a multitude. Wasn't supposed to be out there. You know that story. Wasn't supposed to be there. If they caught her, they would kill her. They would stone her. And Jesus was walking with the guy from the Sanhedrin who had the ability to stone her. And yet she pushed through. She pressed through. This is my chance. I saw him on Fox News. He's going to be downtown. He's going to be in the square. I got to get there. No matter how I can get there, I know they could stone me. I'm going to be slicker than they are. I'm going to get there. Hallelujah. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to get there. And when I get there, I've got it worked out. When I touch him, I'm going to get what I say, and it's going to happen just like I say. And so she went after him, what she had figured out before she left home. You got this guy here, you know, the leper. Here he was. He wasn't supposed to be there. And here he comes up to Jesus. And he says, you know, basically what he says is, you know, is it your will that I be healed? It's what? Now, that's a good Baptist statement. Forgive me, but Methodist, Episcopalian, I mean, all of them. I know Jesus can heal me if it's his will. This one answers that question. This answers that question. If it's his will. Well, the other side of that is, if it's not his will, then die. You come and say, I'm gonna lay hands on you and pray for you. Lord, if it's your will, heal her in Jesus' name. Now, I might as well say, if it's not your will, kill her. Because that's the other side.
Yes.
But we don't ever say anything about the other side.
Amen.
We don't ever say about the other side. And so the age-old question is, if it's the will of the Lord, may the will of the Lord be done. Well, the only time that Jesus prayed that prayer was in the Garden of Gethsemane.
Yes.
And it had nothing to do with healing. Nothing. Nothing. It was talking about consecration. And it was talking about, you know, being faithful to God. It had nothing to do with healing. And why in this world we have tacked that on to when we pray for people to be healed, I do not know why we have done such a crazy thing. We should always pray. So this is what this guy's basically asking. He was asking, I know you can, but I'm not sure you will. That's what everybody will say. I know he can heal me, but you know, some of you may be here already tonight, and you may be saying, well, you know, I don't know. I've lived a good life, and things have been good, and well, then I hadn't lived such a good life either. And matter of fact, I deserve to have this. Oh, don't people tell these people say these things, and said, you know, I just I don't know if it's his will or not, and if he doesn't heal me, it's okay. I'll go on to heaven. Well, the problem with all of this is that Jesus came so we didn't have to make an early journey. He came with purpose in my life and your life, and he came and went to the cross for us, and by his blood, thank God for the blood of Jesus, hallelujah. And so by his stripes we're healed, and the whole thing, you know, have you ever thought about this? When they came out of Egypt, think about it. When they came out of Egypt, there was basically millions that came out. So, all right, if you don't want to go that far, we'll say 1 million, okay? All right, so 1 million, that's a pretty good crowd, came out. And the Bible says in Psalms, not one single person among them was feeble or sick. Now, they didn't bring all 10-year-olds out. They had old people. I mean, really old. They had old people, young people, and here they come, and there is and the blood of Jesus on the doorpost. Oh, hallelujah, the blood of Jesus. Why, they in the house. And you know, the Lord God Almighty had said, anybody who gets in the house, he even said to Gentiles, anybody who gets in the house, you get covered by the blood, you go be protected. We know that because a mixed multitude came out with them. And the blood of Jesus, hallelujah, it was so powerful. It was so strong. It kept death away from them. And evidently, it did some renewing of their bodies. Now, I know you've watched the Ten Commandments on TV. I understand you've seen that. And I know you saw it down at the movie house and all that kind of stuff. But when you see all them weak and sick people and half-dead people, that is not what the Bible said when they came out. Now, that's a miracle of God Almighty. And then even that crazy bunch that went around for 40 years, their shoes didn't even wear out. I mean, when God takes care of you, He will take care of you. He doesn't half do it. Our problem is, we're going back, we put Him in little boxes. And then we interpret how God, we end up interpreting how God relates to our own life. We end up through our concept of God, we basically put our life on this little road that may not be the one God has it on. But because of our thinking and how we've been taught, religion will kill you. You do know that. Yes. Religion will kill you. Yes. And so we get these little thoughts in our minds, and before you know it, you got this little path that you think this is what you're supposed to be in, and it is nothing like what God intended, because it's contradictory to what the Bible teaches. Amen. About what God has for you and what God wants to do for you. Hallelujah. So anyway, here this person, he comes, and Jesus says, I will. Why don't you just look at your neighbor and say, I will. That's what Jesus said. Jesus said, I will. He said, I know you can heal. And he said, huh, I will. Jesus did not say, I'll think about it. I'll pray over it. All right. No, he says, oh, I will. I will. And Jesus put forth his hand, touched him, saying, I will be made clean. And the guy was instantly made clean. I'm telling you. But we had the same issue again. He had to come to Jesus. Listen to me. That guy, he already knew he was unworthy. He was a leper. Yes. Unclean, yes. Unclean, yes. Unclean. Yes. He could be around no one. And the devil is so good at telling us, your past, your life, what's happened to you? You're not worthy. Well, sure enough, that's the truth. No one in here is worthy. But Jesus made us all worthy because of Him. It's Jesus in me that's worthy.